Welcome. I'm Henrice Altink. I'm a professor in the history department, and I'm also one of the co-directors of the Interdisciplinary Global Development Center at the University of York. Caribbean islands are among the most vulnerable countries in the world to climate change. In recent decades, they've experienced more frequent and more intense storms, droughts, floods, and heat waves. The economic and human cost of these disasters have been substantial. A huge amount of money is spent annually on rebuilding houses, hotels, and infrastructure. For example, Hurricane Gilbert, which ravaged Jamaica in 1988, killed 45 people and caused more than $700 million in damage. And because so much money is spent annually on reconstruction after disasters, Caribbean islands have less available for health, education, and social welfare. The 2020 Atlantic hurricane season was the busiest on record. During the various storms that hit the country, Kingston, the capital of Jamaica, experienced a lot of flooding. Much of this was caused by uncollected waste blocking the gullies and drains that run through deprived inner city communities. Local commentators tend to blame inner city residents for the frequent flooding. One journalist, for instance, recently said that ghetto people, quote, willfully dumped garbage. When I first went to Jamaica in the late 1990s for my PhD research, and I saw the rubbish in the gullies, I too thought that residents lacked a concern about the environment. But now, having studied the island's colonial and post-colonial past for more than 20 years, I would argue that Jamaica's unequal social and power relations explain the frequent flooding of inner city communities and more generally, the vulnerability of inner city residents to climate change. While all residents in Kingston have to cope with storms and heavy rains, like other cities in the global south, it's the inner city poor that are the most vulnerable because of where they live and the lack of resources to prepare for and repair after a disaster. But also making them vulnerable to climate change is the anti-poor bias by politicians and service providers, which affects such things as where water and sewer lines are extended, where waste is regularly collected, or whose houses are rebuilt after a storm. This anti-poor bias is largely a skin tone bias. As I've shown in my recent book, long after independence, Jamaica remained a pigmentocracy, that is, a society in which light skin bestows status. Because of their long-standing socialization into a black is no good ethos, Jamaican politicians and other elites, whether they are light or dark-skinned, look down upon inner city residents who are mostly dark-skinned because of the close association between class and color. And this in turn has blinded politicians and service providers to the needs of inner city residents. In my current project, I examine the environmental vulnerability of Kingston's inner city residents from independence in 1962 to the present, focusing not just on natural disasters and slow onset climate change, such as rising temperatures, but also on everyday environmental risks caused by poor access to water, waste, and sanitation services. Location and quality of housing are critical determinants of environmental vulnerability. This map from 1960 shows the distribution of dark-skinned residents across the city of Kingston. The areas with the highest proportion of dark-skinned residents were also the most deprived communities, such as Trenchtown, the birthplace of reggae, illustrating the close connection between class and color. Kingston's map of deprived inner city communities has more or less stayed the same throughout the post-colonial period, but more informal housing settlements have been added over time because of increased rural to urban migration and a shortage of affordable housing. As in other parts of the global south, the informal housing settlements are the most vulnerable to climate change because they are built on marginal land, on hillsides or on the banks of rivers and gullies, they're poorly constructed, and because their residents lack land tenure, they cannot get access to water, waste or sanitation services. Informal housing residents then rely on the standpipe or an illegal connection for pipe water. They use pit latrines, and because waste collectors don't enter these settlements, They usually burn or bury waste or dump it into gullies. In his 1964 novel, The Children of Sisyphus, the sociologist Orlando Patterson captured the condition of the residents of one of the largest informal housing settlements of Dongle, where mostly Rastafarians lived in shacks, as you can read here. The Dongle was bulldozed down in 1966 and replaced by Tivoli Gardens, a low-income housing project that, like many others erected in the 1960s and 70s, aimed to provide the ruling party with votes. Since the 1980s, the government of Jamaica has moved away from providing finished housing for low-income households to providing land and access to basic services. But poor inner city residents have not benefited much from these less overtly partisan housing initiatives. The majority of mortgage holders of these projects have earned well above the median income, and the main mortgage provider for low-income households, the National Housing Trust, has always excluded informal workers who make up half of the labor force and reside mostly in inner city communities. Because of a lack of affordable housing, then, Kingston's poor have lived in informal housing settlements on the edges of the city or in overcrowded and mostly run-down houses in the more central and downtown areas. Alongside their location and quality of housing, inner city residents' difficulty in accessing reliable water, waste, and sanitation services has done much to enhance their environmental vulnerability. Since the late 1960s, water and sewer lines have been extended and are still being extended across Kingston. Yet the number of inner city residents connected to water and sewer lines has always lagged behind, as this table illustrates. Various factors explain why many inner city residents are not connected to the water and sewer systems. Firstly, planning processes have often prioritized the extension of water and sewer lines in new middle-class areas rather than in inner city areas. Second, when decisions were made to extend water and sewer lines in inner city communities, mostly with support from international donors, it often proved difficult to find contractors willing to work in these areas because the communities were associated with crime and violence. This stigmatization of inner city residents also made the National Water Commission more reluctant to repair or upgrade water and sewer lines in these areas. And third, getting connected to water and sewer mains has always been a time-consuming and above all, a costly process, including the hiring of an approved plumber and a hefty application fee. Contrary to informal housing settlement, waste collection has not been absent in slum areas in downtown Kingston, but service here has always been poor. Garbage trucks have struggled to get into the narrow streets, and when communal skips were installed in some areas to make collection easier, they were often set on fire during inter or intra-community violence, while waste collectors at times have refused to enter certain communities because of violence. Also, the waste services in Kingston have been underfunded, so that always a large number of trucks were out of service, necessitating the adjustment of the collection schedules, which then tended to prioritize middle-class areas. Because they lacked the means to buy big metal bins and a garden to unstir uncollected waste in between infrequent collections, many inner-city residents have had to bury, burn, or dump waste, causing soil and air pollution. Access to waste, water, and sanitation services in Kingston's inner city communities then has been poor, but how does this relate to climate change? Jamaica, like many other Caribbean islands, has been experiencing more frequent and more severe droughts, driven by rising temperatures and below average rainfall. Along with leaky pipes caused by aging water infrastructure, especially in the central and downtown areas, this has affected the water supply for Kingston and has led the National Water Commission to frequently issue lock-offs, sometimes lasting for weeks. While all residents in Kingston experience lock-offs, they are particularly hard for inner city residents. They cannot step in a car and drive to the nearest supermarket to bulk buy water. Instead, they have to walk some distance to the nearest standpipe or to the river and get water, sometimes using trolleys and other means to get it home, and some also purchase water from private suppliers that is expensive and often of poor quality. But also the quality of pipe water consumed by inner city residents is not very good. Over the years, groundwater has been increasingly contaminated by saline intrusion caused by rising sea levels and also by sewage seepage. As I mentioned earlier, not all inner city households are connected to the sewer system, either because sewer mains have not yet been extended in the area or because they cannot afford to get connected. They then mostly use pit latrines, which contribute to groundwater contamination, along with leaking sewer lines, especially in downtown Kingston, where the first sewers were laid in 1893 and are in much need of upgrading. And the aging water and sewer infrastructure, along with poor waste collection and failure to regularly clean and drain gullies of waste, have enhanced the risk of flooding in inner city communities during storms and heavy rains. For example, during Tropical Storm Gilda in 1973, some 50 residents of the McGregor Gullet area were airlifted when floods destroyed their home. And more recently in 2010, during Storm Nicole, various houses in Augustown were destroyed when the Hope River overflowed. But floods also pose health risks for inner city residents as they cause sewers to overflow and the standing water attracts mosquitoes carrying such diseases as dengue and chikungunya. While homeowners have usually received some government support to repair or replace damaged houses, tenants and squatters have had to rely mostly on emergency relief. But not only were the houses the least resistant to natural disasters, tenants and squatters have also lacked the resources to repair damage. For example, Cherise Troop, who lived in central Kingston, had to take shelter in a nearby school during Hurricane Dean in 2007. But by the time Hurricane Gustav approached a year later, the zinc roof of her house was still full of holes. Limited access to water, waste and sanitation services, and the location and quality of housing then, has exposed Kingston's inner city residents to numerous environmental risks, from air pollution caused by the burning of uncollected waste to leaking sewers, and also the risk of flooding during storms. Since independence in 1962, these risks have increased because of population growth, urbanization, and climate change. I've tried to show that where people live in Kingston and their access to basic services is deeply political. Certainly, a lack of financial resources has limited the ability of the Jamaican government to extend and improve water, waste, and sanitation services. Its debt burden has been increasing because of more frequent and more intense natural disasters that require rebuilding, and international lenders also insist that it pays off debts so that there is less money to upgrade aging water and sewer infrastructure or to buy more garbage trucks. But the lack of access to basic services in inner city communities is also because successive Jamaican governments have always been more concerned with the needs of the elite than with the poor as a result of long-standing race and class relations. And political partisanship has also enhanced the environmental vulnerability of inner city residents. Not long after Hurricane Ivan in 2004, calls were made to adopt no-build zones in areas prone to natural disasters. Only in 2018, a law was passed that allowed for the building of such zones. But even today, after the busiest Atlantic season on record, no such area has been declared because most of the informal settlements in disaster-prone areas have declared allegiance to one of the two parties. And because inner-city communities are largely seen as voting blocks, MPs and councillors rarely pay attention to their environmental problems outside election time. When referring to a gully in the community that had been blocked for years and about which they had long complained, one Duhani Park resident remarked, quote, "Things will never be better for we." To avoid the houses being flooded or washed away then, inner city residents have often had no choice but to clean drains and gullies themselves ahead of a storm. And inner city residents have also been failed by environmental NGOs. Because of external financial pressures and the anti-poor bias, they prioritize global green agenda issues such as the conservation of cockpit country, where bauxite mining is causing a loss of biodiversity. And they neglect then local brown agenda issues such as uncollected waste. The political will then to listen to and provide inner city residents with better access to basic services is unlikely to improve soon, as partisanship is so ingrained in Jamaican political culture, as is an anti-poor and anti-Black bias. But I want to end on a hopeful note. Led by the Economic Commission for Latin America and the Caribbean, for several years now, calls have been made to push international lenders to swap the bed of Caribbean islands for climate adaptation. The current pandemic has increased the momentum for this form of debt relief for the Caribbean. If lenders agree, then debt for climate swaps could be used to fund improvements in water, waste, and sanitation services, and also to climate-proof low-income housing.